send me the location. Then I'll be right there. Then make her come check you, my baby. No time, no. And my dog is on probation. Another 5 years. And bring girls to his location. No time, no.
Send me the location. This year about vacations. Flight catching, train taking. Soon as my nigga runs.
All right, y'all, welcome to another episode of the Unmanly Podcast here on YouTube, Apple Music, and Spotify. This is going to be another episode where I'm actually re-recording one that I recorded in the car from my recent drive from Toronto back to Ottawa. And unfortunately, again, the audio quality on this episode also wasn't that great, so I just had to pull the transcript out, take a couple of notes, whoop. And re-record this one again. So this one, I can't even remember what I wanted to title it, but this one's mostly about our words and our choices and the energy that we choose to put into this, and the energy that we choose to put into this world when it comes to our voice. Of course, this is very important to me as I am a podcaster, and obviously using my voice a lot for work, for purpose, for passion. So just my thoughts based on how we can start to make better choices when it comes to the things that we say, because this has been extremely profound for me and this has really changed my life. So speaking of things that have changed my life, a lot of this, or what's in this episode, was actually brought upon the book, The Four Agreements, by Don Miguel Ruiz. And this is a book that I recommend to a lot of people when it comes to spirituality. I recommend it as like a very strong starter book because it's an extremely easy read. It's only 100-something pages long. So if you're a very good and avid reader, you could probably smash this book out in like a day or two max. But even if you want to take a little bit longer, and I do recommend taking longer with these types of books because, you know, the best results you'll get with these books is when you read them and reflect on them at the same time. So there are four agreements. So even if you want to take one day to read each agreement and then reflect on it for a day and then come back to it, I think that's the best way that you can absorb this particular book. So I won't go over what all the entire four agreements are, but the first agreement that's in the book is being impeccable with your word. And what being impeccable with your word means, basically watching what you say, because what you say is basically energy that you put out into the stratosphere, into the world. And is there, and there's a ripple effect based on the words and the choice of words that you use. So this episode is a little bit mindset based a little bit, where you can start to be a little bit more aware of thoughts and, more importantly, more the words that you are actually saying. A lot of people, I mean, you might have heard that whole thing about, you know, spelling is called spelling because, you know, it's almost like you're casting spells with your word. And believe what you may about magic, but I really believe in that. That really resonates with me because you are basically casting spells on people with your words. And there are entire disciplines like NLP, neuro-linguistic programming, that is based upon the vocabulary that you choose. I hear all the time from clients and from friends, you know, different word choices that they use. Like I'm a very big linguist. Like I love podcasting. I love writing. I used to love essays for some reason. I didn't really love school, but there was something about writing papers and essays that I really liked. I was into poetry a lot too, when I was young, and I'll touch upon some of those stories in a later episode. But words and choices of words have always been something that's been very special to me, and the choice of words that that particular person likes to use, because there's so many different synonyms for things, and it's interesting to see people's word choices. And I can almost kind of read people a little bit based on the choice of words that they use. And in some cases, they're a lot more obvious than other cases. And I wanted to bring this up because I had a chat with a friend, a new friend actually in Toronto, who I was introduced to from my best friend, Jerry Ajit. And he was, we were just going back and forth on a lot of things, and he was bringing out a lot of like deep stuff out of me, and I really appreciated that, and I thanked him for that. But we got to the conversation about, you know, you have to be very careful about what you say, because it's not always just what you say that's apparent, that's going out there. It's kind of what you're saying and what you're not saying based on kind of what you're saying too, right? So for example, if someone is going to say, or if I tell someone, let's say I have a friend and, you know, there's an application that he has to do online or something, And I say, yeah, you know, it's easy. Just go onto online, go onto this website, and then there's this portal that you got to go through. And then like from there, you just fill out your information and then boom, you're good. And a friend may reply back to me by saying, I don't do computers, man. I don't do technology, man. You know what I mean? Which is like very, it's interesting because like, what are you saying when you're saying that? What are you not saying when you're saying that? And what is being said by you saying that, basically, kind of thing, right? So it's as if, okay, so when someone says that, it's not that they, okay, so based on fact, just looking at that statement at face value, is that they do not, they're not familiar with technology, or they don't, but then further based on that, not only are they not familiar with it, they are not willing to learn it, they are not willing to try, and they may, taking it a little bit further, may be a type of person who could be a little bit not so independent and not willing to try new things. So this is why you got to be very careful when you say stuff like this, because like, you know, people will cast an opinion or a judgment based on what you say, but that's not important anyways, right? Who cares really what someone thinks about you? But when it comes down to your own self and your own, you know, self-sufficiency, and your own independence, that statement reigns very, very heavily. So, and there's other examples of it too, right? When you say, I have to do something. It's really out of necessity. I think we touched upon this a little bit in the habits episode that I recorded in the car earlier before this conversation. And it was about saying that like, oh, I need to get into a fitness routine because I need to lose weight and I have to go to the gym 5 or 6 times a week. I have to go running. I have to do cardio. But when you tell yourself that you have to do things all the time, you're basically telling yourself that you have to force yourself to do it. And you give yourself the choice to say whether yes or no. And if you have to do something, more likely than not, it'll be a no. Instead, if you flip it around, and again, it's just a mindset thing. It's just a wording thing. If you start to say, instead of I have to, some people say I get to. It's like, oh, I get the opportunity to work out today. I get to work out 5 times a week. Isn't this amazing? Isn't this fantastic? And then taking it even a step further into an identity shift, saying, instead of I have to work out this week, I am a person who works out regularly. I am a person who works out every single day. And in doing that, you will just do the things that type of person does, right? If I'm a person who exercises every single day, then I will just naturally exercise every single day because that's just what I do. I have experienced this very, very strongly in my life the last little while, and it's really helped me kind of shed bad habits and kind of develop new habits a little bit. Even going back to creating content all the time, I am a type of person who creates content that is meaningful for my audience. And now I'm just the type of person who does that. I schedule that into my week now because this is just what I do. It's been extremely powerful for me. So just based on those couple of examples, I know they're very simple kind of examples, but you can kind of see like the power of the spells that you have and the power of vocabulary choice that has on your life too. And the impact that it has on the other people around you. Right? You can be very inspiring to the people around you, or you can be very draining to the people around you based on the words that you use. And sometimes the victim vocabulary that you choose to use, or I'm always like this, I'm always like that. Those are two words that I'm always, well, I just said always, but I'm very careful when I use the words always and never, because I love the quote, never say never, because anything is possible. I really believe anything is possible. I tell myself that. It's my inner narrative. And then also always, when I'm always like this, or always this, oh, things are always like this. Oh, this always happens to me. It's very victim and external validation based kind of thinking. So I'm very careful when I'm faced with the words of always, instead of I'm saying like something positive, like I'm always happy, you know, I always try to be happy. Like something like that is great. But when it comes to, you know, when it comes to a victim kind of mindset, victim mentality, be very careful when you use the word always, because that's basically saying that you're always a victim of your circumstances, which is not true. You actually have full sovereignty over your own thoughts and the things that happen to you quite a bit, more than you probably know. If you're someone who always says, always, I'm always this, I'm always that, this always happens to me. This, I don't know why, but this always happens to me. Or I'm never going to be good at this. I'm never going to be good at that. Like, oh, I'm never going to learn how to do this. I'm never going to be great like that. And then he challenged me actually with saying that, like, with my whole limitless and anything is possible and all these opportunities are always like, you know, are always abundant for me. And he's like, well, if you think anything is possible, how come you can't, you know, fly or anything like that? And I told him, it's interesting that you actually said that, because like, as I was walking to my friend's apartment earlier this day, I thought about, I do have a very limitless kind of opportunity, but like, why can't I be an NBA player? And I thought about that and I was like, okay, well, it's not so much the choice or the thinking of like, why can't I be an NBA player? It's more so that I'm choosing my thoughts more optimally and more wisely, instead of focusing on things like, oh, what I can't be, right? Because all the energy that I spend on talking about things that I can't be is energy that I'm taking away from something that I could be doing that's more positive and like more conducive and more towards my goal. You know what I mean? Than a thought about something limiting or a thought about something that I can't do. So, and maybe if I was really young and I worked every single day for it and got really hard for it, I worked really hard for it, then maybe I could have been an NBA player. But then again, of course, there's physical limitations. But the point is that instead of focusing on these limitations and focusing on the why nots, focusing more so on the possibilities and the more of the, instead of the why not, how about why not? Right? So that's something that's very, very been very profound in my life. And that's something that I, like when I coach people and when I talk to people about mindset and my friends, my family is to focus more on the words and the thoughts that you're having. One of my life coach teachers, Kane Ramsey, had coined the idea of policing your thoughts a little bit, policing the thoughts that come in and out of your head and the words that come in and out of your head, because words come from thoughts. And when thoughts become words, then they become actions, right? So if you recognize that chain, then you know that like everything comes from within a thought and within a word, right? When you decree something, when you say something, when you cast a spell, it's very, very important. So be very, very mindful of that. When I went through therapy after my divorce back in 2016, I was always a very loud person. I'm still a kind of a very loud and very outspoken person. But before, I've realized in therapy that like I can often be loud and you know, loud spoken and what was the term I just used? Outspoken, sorry. I could be outspoken because I was very insecure, right? I didn't feel like I had power in the room and I felt like I had to say something to be noticed. Today, even sometimes still, like I still feel like I'm invisible in some rooms unless I actually go out there and say something. I became a professional MC actually, and I was like shit scared to become a professional MC, but I did it over time. It took a really long time, but I knew I always wanted to get out there and be loud and kind of have the attention of the room, maybe for insecure reasons, but it's been very empowering since then, being able to be a professional MC and getting paid to actually get out there and just speak on a microphone. It's been fantastic. But in the past, I used to always feel like I had to be loud or I would be ignored, and that was it. My therapist changed my life. The most important thing that he ever said within all of those sessions during that time, and he was great. He was a father. He related to me, and he was a very pivotal person. I want to give him props for being a very monumental person within this whole men's mental health kind of journey that I've kind of been on. So thank you. Appreciate that. I can't remember his name at the top of my head. Darcy. Yes, Darcy. Thank you, Darcy. And where I am now, sorry, what he said was like, Andy, why do you feel like you always have to be the loudest person in the room? Like, did you not know, or have you never thought about, you know, the fact that perhaps it's the most silent person in the room who is the most powerful? And I thought about that, and that like almost basically went against everything that I'd ever thought about in my life. And I was like, wait, why? Like everyone ignores the quiet guy, you know, like who cares about no one even notices him. But I responded to when he said that with complete silence. And for the first time in my life, I didn't have something to say back. I didn't have a rebuttal. I didn't have anything. And I thought about that, and it made a lot of sense. It did make a lot of sense. Because that made me dive right deep into my insecurities, right? Because like, if I'm such an insecure person that I feel like I have to say something to get noticed, I'm actually believing that I am not worth being noticed if I don't say something. So that is weakness. And the person who is silent, the person who is comfortable within himself, the person who's just pondering and accepting and just observing and, you know, proactively thinking about his next move, that person holds the most power in the room. So, I mean, in reality, it's probably something in the middle, right? And it's probably circumstantial, but like that particular lesson was very, very profound for me. And then it really led me down a path of being more intentional with my words. And that was very impactful. What else was in here? I mean, that's basically it. Like, I think like this episode was really just about becoming more aware of your thoughts and your words and the power that they have. So maybe think about, you know, where in your life can you reflect on this and see, you know, what are the words that you're saying to people, right? What are people hearing you say every single day, and how maybe is it affecting them, and how can you adjust the words that you use or your vocabulary choice in order to inspire yourself and inspire others in your life, especially your children. It's extremely, extremely important. Also cultivating a mindset habit of reading all the time, like reading books like The Four Agreements, which will lead you down a rabbit hole of many other books for self-development, because self-development is my thing. And if you need to develop a habit of reading books, you know, start slowly, just like meditation, start very slowly. Tell yourself you're a person who likes to read and work on your self-development so that you will just do those type of things that that type of person does. That will help a lot. And then just continue to absorb, continue to apply, continue to reflect on the things that you're reading and share it with others, like I'm sharing right now. So, again, if you've read the book or if you have any other book recommendations, feel free to reach out to me on social media. Talk to me about your experiences. I personally love how that book is written. So definitely check it out. On audiobook, it's like super, super fast. Like, I would be surprised if it was more than like 3 hours on an audiobook, because it's really only 100 something pages long. So definitely check that out if that's your thing. I love audiobooks on like a long drive. So for example, when I was originally recording this episode, like instead of just being on audiobooks for those couple of hours, I decided to record instead. But I typically, when I do my 4.5 hour drives from Toronto to Ottawa, I usually always have an audiobook on, and I'm trying to learn and I'm trying to get different perspectives on life a little bit and how I could better make decisions. Like what words do I want to choose? So, and also, my words of wisdom for today is if you find yourself as someone who's using a lot of victim vocabulary, I'm always like this, or this always happens to me, immediately stop. Cause I think that it's hard to change our habits, right? It's hard to even change our thoughts. It's definitely hard to change our actions in the world. But I think the easiest thing to change within us, and it could be the best first step to becoming more of the person you want to be, or your high self, or your authentic self, whatever you want to call it, to get better or to be better, you know, by choice, of course. I'm not saying you're not, you know, where you need to be, or you're not great. You're fantastic. But choosing your words, I think policing your words out of all of those things is the easiest start, right? Just choosing not to say something. Even if you're thinking about it, just choose not to let it out if you think it's something that is going to hurt someone else, or is going to either hurt you or do nothing good for you, right? Start by policing your words. Start by listening to the people that you admire and the people that you want to be with, and just look at their vocabulary choice. See what they're talking about and try to follow that. Try to follow and mirror that as much as possible. If you see qualities in people that you really like, then like take note of those qualities and then try to move more towards them in your life. And this is always very helpful, very helpful. But I know how tough it is. I grew up in the hood, and like the vocabulary in the hood is, it is what it is, right? And I've been since removed from the hood a little bit to be able to give myself a bit more perspective on like the words that I want to be using and the way that I want to be talking. I don't want to be talking in no victim language. I don't want to be talking in no, you know, languages where I feel disadvantaged and things like that. So be very, very aware of the words that you're spoken and the words that are spoken to you that you take influence from. Gratitude wise, words of gratitude, words of love, are always extremely powerful in this world. If you can tell someone that, you know, something that will make their day, you know, that they're beautiful, that they're smart, that you appreciate their energy, these are positive, great spells that you could put out there, and you can really change someone's life. They might even never forget about you, depending how good your quality or your compliment is. So I want to give that to you. Thank you so much for listening to this podcast. Thank you for taking whatever value it is that you're getting out of this. I would love your words back, not your words of praise or your words of gratitude. Just you taking the time to listen to my episodes is to me a very strong sign of appreciation and gratitude. And I accept that. I receive that. I would love, however, your words of feedback or criticism, whether it's constructive or not, whatever you want to say, right? If you think I look silly from this camera angle too, I'm totally down to hear it. So feedback is so important to me based on, you know, what you guys are resonating with, what you guys want more to listen to, and what you want me to talk about, really, right? Because I want to build this as a resource for you and for the world. So if you can share it and spread it, I'd be even more grateful. I'd be over the moon about it. So I really, really appreciate you guys. Thank you so much. I will see you guys in the next one. And because I am now a person that creates content, you will be hearing a lot more of me. And I hope that's okay. And if that is okay, I appreciate you and I thank you so very much. All right, take care.